And one of the, so the goal and the objective here of this class is for us to get a deeper appreciation of our weekly worship that we get to participate in corporately. Worship is a huge topic, and so in the next 35 minutes, we're just going to be able to kind of scratch the surface of it, and hopefully by the end of it, we'll have some new understandings to be able to enjoy the worship that we get to participate in. When we talk about worship, just a quick definition, worship we know from Scripture is not just what we do when we come together and when we sing songs and when we gather together in church building. That is a form of corporate or together worship. But we know from Scripture that God receives our whole lives offered to Him as our reasonable act of worship. It says in Romans 12, 1 and 2. And so we know worship is something that's very comprehensive. And the way I've been thinking about it, and the way that you're going to hear me talk about it in the year ahead with our church, is that all these different acts of worship that we participate in, our obedience, our prayer, spending time in Scripture, singing songs to the Lord, they're all little acts of worship, and they're offerings that we give to God. And when we come together on a weekly basis as a community, it's a unique feast that we get to participate in. When else do we get to sing songs all together with God's people? When else do we get to have the Word of God explained for us by one of our pastors? When do we get to receive the sacrament? And there's a uniqueness about all these little acts of worship coming together in a weekly feast or banquet. And so you'll see on your sheet here, worship is a feast. Theologian John Piper says that. And then also right under it, we say it every week. Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. And what do we say?
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
So this worship that we participate in is a feast. And depending on where we're at in our spiritual journey, some of us get to experience that and enjoy that, and we feel that and sense that. And for others of us on a different stage of the journey, we're still developing a taste and appreciation for those things. And none of us has fully arrived, and so the more we enter into worship, the more we're going to get to enjoy the fullness of this feast that God's prepared for us. And it's actually something that we're going to get to grow in appreciation for in all of eternity. And as we gather together to learn about worship, this is an investment in enjoying the feast today. So let me give us a little bit of historic and theological context. You'll hear me referring to us as an Anglican church, which is the tradition that we are worshiping in. And so I'll get to explain that a little bit and explain why that's a faithful and beautiful way to worship. And so first, when we talk about the worship that we're participating in here at St. Paul's, it's an Anglican worship, and sometimes in Anglican circles, you hear what's referenced to as a three streams worship. And so what we have here is we have different streams or traditions of the Christian church that are coming together. Think of these as like three rivers that are coming together into one unified river. And this particular expression of Christianity, we believe that there are limits. We believe that we can't come together with Kool-Aid and potato chips and say that we've celebrated the sacrament. We believe that there are limits. People can't just stand up and claim, God told me last night I'm a prophet, and so I'm supposed to be leading this ministry. We have boundaries, but part of the Anglican expression of faith is that we believe that the boundaries should be broad. We shouldn't be drawing lines of separation at every excuse we have, because this person takes a little cracker and we take a bigger cracker, we need to be separate denominations. We don't buy that. We think for the most part God's bringing together a unity of worship of His people. And if we're going to have to separate or just be distinct from others, we think it needs to be on something that's major. Like, they don't believe that Jesus is really the Son of God. That's a big deal. You know, we have to get that thing worked out before we say we're worshiping together. And so it's beautiful in the sense that it's comprehensive. We're trying to be as inclusive as possible while still at the same time having clear biblical limits. So all that to say, what kind of denominations or backgrounds or traditions are y'all familiar with that are part of your story? Just call them out.
Baptist.
Pentecostal.
Evangelical, Calvary Chapel.
I call myself a denominational mutt, so yeah. Came to the Lord in a Pentecostal church. I've been involved in Baptist. I was a pastor of Baptist church, served at a Presbyterian church, served at a Congregational church, et cetera, et cetera. And often, not always, but often, if you're worshiping at a Pentecostal church, you know, they'll look down on the Catholic church and say, oh, the Catholic, you know, they don't know the Lord. And then you go to the Catholic church and they're looking down on the Pentecostal, oh, they don't know the Lord. And you go to the Pentecostal church and, you know, they're weeping over the Baptist, they don't know the Lord. And so there's a lot of, you know, bombs that are thrown over those fences. And I don't, within the Anglican tradition, we don't believe we need to draw lines between every little different denomination. And so the three streams that you'll find coming together within the Anglican expression of faith include the Catholic stream. And by Catholic stream, that doesn't just mean Roman Catholic, but it means the historic branches of the Christian church. So you're talking about Roman Catholic, you're talking about Eastern Orthodox churches, churches that have their roots in their worship style that goes all the way back to the early centuries of the church. And then you'll have the stream called the evangelical. Check my spelling. And so the evangelical stream, you're talking about your Calvary Chapels, your Baptists, your folks who say the Word of God, you know, that's what's important, that's what we need, is the Scriptures and Scriptures alone. And so you've got that evangelical stream. This would also include your Protestant denominations that came out of the Reformation, so Presbyterian and Methodist. And then so down here then you have another stream that comes up, and that's your Pentecostal stream. And to clarify, when we talk about a three streams worship, we're not saying that we as Anglican Christians, we as St. Paul's, are going to choose one of these three streams. What we're saying is we believe that these are all traditions that God works through. They're all part of God's church. And our heart and desire is to be seeing these things come together in our worship, rather than trying to draw divisions and separate in these different areas. We believe that God's working in all these places. And so these three streams come together to make one small C Catholic stream, a universal stream that includes kind of these different traditions of worship that come together into a three streams worship. And so that's why sometimes when you show up at St. Paul's, you know, sometimes you'll hear folks, you know, shouting and expressing, you know, charismatic praise or speaking a word from the Lord, like you might in a Pentecostal church. And then you'll see somebody up in robes and breaking the sacrament like you would at a Catholic church. And then you see somebody preaching like somebody really needs to get saved and know the Lord, like at a Baptist church. And we believe that those are all beautiful, faithful expressions of worship before God. And we think it's beautiful. We're trying to bring those things back together. And part of the goal and the value is that we really believe that Christ wants a unified church. And that's our future. That's our destiny. That's where we're headed. And so we even have this thing, it's on your sheets, called the Lambeth Quadrilateral. And this is hundreds of years ago that Anglican folks actually came up with frameworks and said, we believe that this is the space where Jesus is going to be uniting his bride in the future. And we actually laid out, like, okay, bare minimum requirements. You got to sign off on these four things if you're going to be part of this united church moving forward. And it wasn't things like you have to believe that, you know, there's going to be a rapture, you know, like the next 50 years. They didn't say you have to believe that you have to receive communion on your knees. You know, it's not all the little minor details that we can, you know, enjoy getting angry at over each other. These are like the big main things everyone needs to be able to sign off on to be considered part of Christ's bride universally and forever. Any ideas what those things might be? One of them?
Worshiping idols?
No worshiping idols. Okay, that falls under a broader topic that says we believe the things in here.
So you're talking about worship, but these four blanks concerning worship?
Yes, this is the context. So I'm kind of laying the foundation of why we worship the way we do.
Okay.
So one of those, that it's biblical. right? And this goes to your point of having no idols. So this worship,
God, I want it.
Right, and that's all part of it. We believe the Old and New Testaments are God's word, and we all have to build something on them. Now, part of the challenge of that is everybody claims that their stuff comes from God's word. And so, you know, the Jehovah's Witness Church says, well, we really believe the word of God, you know, as it says, but then there's been some things that have changed, and so they don't necessarily believe that Jesus is the Son of God. So there's another important piece to being biblical within these boundaries, and that's called being creedal. And what this means is we believe that understanding the scriptures is not just up to whoever wants to open the Bible and say they believe the word of God and then to share, well, this is what the word of God means. We believe that your interpretation of the Bible needs to be consistent with the unified creeds of the early church. So every week we come together and we say a creed together. Apostles' Creed, Nicene Creed, one of the creeds that go back to the very early centuries of the church. And so what we're saying is, if we were to sum up what the Bible says in one white hot core, we believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son. We believe in the Holy Spirit, his church. And so the worship here that's being united and coming together, it's according to the word of God. And our interpretation of the word of God is according to the creeds of the church. We're not making up something new or some new interpretation. If you have any questions, please feel free to interject. Does it make sense why we want to be a creedal church? We're not trying to come up with something new, but we're trying to believe what's been believed since the time of Jesus and the apostles and the early church.
Foundations,
definitely. We're not out here to rehash this thing. You know, there's been faithful believers and God's Holy Spirit has been moving from that time. All right, so four things. We're biblical, we're creedal. This is within the Lambeth quadrilateral. Another thing is that we are sacramental. Now, to be sacramental means that when we come together, yes, we teach the word of God, yes, we believe in the creeds, but also we believe that part of the way that God has instructed us to worship are through the sacraments. And especially through the Anglican Church, they would emphasize the two primary sacraments. Any guesses as what the two primary sacraments are that Jesus gave the church? Communion, Eucharist, Lord's Supper, and baptism. So those are the two big ones. Now, the Catholic Church would want to say, well, there's actually seven sacraments. Some, you know, denominations express will say, no, we don't believe there's sacraments. The Anglican Church says, there are sacraments. There are these things, these ways of worshiping God that Jesus initiated that we need to continue. And that is primarily the Lord's Supper and baptism. The Anglican Church, in typical fashion, would say, yeah, we also believe there's kind of these five minor ones, but we can agree to disagree on those ones. We need to at least agree on these two big ones, Eucharist and baptism. And then finally, and this one is a little bit outside the box for evangelical folks, and so I'm not going to have you guess because we'll be here for quite a while. But the fourth one, as relates to an Anglican perspective of what needs to happen for us to be united in Christ Church moving forward, is we need what's called an apostolic episcopacy.
That was right what I was going to say.
It was on the tip of my tongue.
Yeah, really, thanks for that. You know that.
And so apostolic episcopacy primarily means this in 1 minute or less. It means that historically, any time Jesus has brought unity in through his church, it's been under the authority of the bishop. And so as you follow church history, the ones who primarily were in authority to be able to unify Christ's church, going back to when the early church was spreading and you started to have apostles overseeing regions, and eventually what went on to become bishops over all sorts of different even nations, there was always an office of the episcopacy, the bishopric, that oversaw a particular area so that there was somebody who could give some clarity about, okay, here's what we're going to do as a church in a particular region. And this is a foreign concept for us because since the time of the Reformation, it just splintered in so many thousands of ways that unless you're part of an Eastern Orthodox Church or Roman Catholic Church, you have very little experience or interest in an apostolic presidency. Now, apostolic means, and this is interesting, that this bishopric is not just something, and this happens in our culture today, it's not just something where somebody becomes prominent, they become like a celebrity, and so they have a title in front of their name, and what's the title? Bishop so-and-so, right? Apostolic means actually that this authority, this episcopal authority that's been given you was actually bishops laying hands on you that actually had the hands laid on them and hands laid on them that actually can be traced back all the way to the time of the apostles of Christ. And so in Roman Catholic churches, Eastern Orthodox churches, Anglican churches, there's a continuity of a lineage that goes all the way back to the apostles of Christ, which is really cool. Like the priest and the bishop who laid hands on me, like I got to go one time, he pulled out his truck this scroll, and the scroll, you know, lists all the bishops all the way back to the time of the Reformation and then back into the Catholic Church of who laid hands, you know, and those are the folks that set aside our pastors or folks that have, you know, this connection all the way back to the time of Christ and the apostles, which is really cool. So they said if we're gonna be united as Christ Church moving forward, these four things are going to describe us. We don't want to come up with all sorts of minor details that separate us. Let's agree to agree. You know, let's agree on these major things, and then we can work out some of the minor things. Some of the context for our worship. Now let me move on to get into some more of the particulars. Let me turn our attention here to the church calendar, and I've got a picture of it up here as well. And so this talks about how, as we worship on a regular basis here, part of our worship is liturgical, which means that it's not just what we come up with on the spot. It's something that we've inherited. It's something that we believe. Something that we believe should not just be whatever comes to us spontaneously, but that we should also be gleaning from what the Holy Spirit has inspired through the centuries and what's come before us. We want to learn from all those things. Similar at a wedding, you don't want somebody leading your wedding. Who's just going to say, oh, don't worry, I'll just do it off the cuff, and don't worry, I'll work it out, and I'll say whatever comes to mind. But this is a big deal. This is a covenant commitment that's supposed to last for a lifetime. In the same way, part of being liturgical means that when we come together and worship, we believe this is a big deal. We believe this is a covenant commitment that's supposed to last forever. And so we have some reverence, we have some respect about it. So we come together, we worship in a way that's ordered, liturgical. And part of that is also one of the tools that we use is the church calendar. And similarly to the time of the Jewish faith, they had seasons and celebrations throughout the year that helped train them in the things that were supposed to be important to them and the festivals that were supposed to help them remember what God had done throughout redemptive history. In the same way, as we go into the early churches of the Christian year, the Christian church similarly started to use this tool of annual celebrations to help disciple people, to help form people into the rhythms of the life of Jesus. And so there's lots of different models that you can use. This one, the colors show the different colors of the church calendar year. The colors represent different things. This concept that there are 12 days of Christmas. And so that's something that's on the calendar that we celebrate is 12 days of Christmas here. But then following the Christmas celebration, then we have a season that follows Christmas that helps us understand some of the implications of what Christmas meant. Anybody know what this season following Christmas is called?
Well, it's on the page. It's an epiphany.
Epiphany.
Cheater. But.
Count it. So this is now the Christmas cycle. So part of our year, we're anticipating the birth of Christ. We're celebrating the birth of Christ. And then in Epiphany, we're looking at some of the implications of what it means that Christ has come into the world. And so Epiphany, we often think of an Epiphany being the light bulb going on over someone's head. In the church calendar context, it has some of those same implications, but primarily it means that this gift that God gave to the Jews as Messiah has now been able to go out to the Gentiles, to all the peoples of the world. This is a gift in which everyone's included. That light bulb goes on for every tongue and tribe and nation. Epiphany. So this is the Christmas cycle. And then we have the other cycle. And so what's the other huge event that we remember every year as relates to Christ?
Easter.
Easter, right?
Yeah, Easter here. Put another star.
On your calendar here, it only has a star at Christmas. It should have a star at Easter. And so we have a season leading up to Easter, which is a preparation season. And what's that season called?
Lent.
Lent. So this is our Easter preparations, and the end of Lent is Passion Week, which is a particularly intensive and unique time of us preparing for the celebration of Easter. And then we have the Easter season, and rather than it being 1 day celebration, it's a 7 day celebration with 7 weeks more of celebration. And guess what season we're in right now? We're in white. So this is a white season. Anytime we're in a high celebration service, we're wearing whites and golds. And so you've been hearing some tambourines lately, and you know we've been getting excited, right? We're in one of these high points of our year right now, of being able to celebrate the death and resurrection of Jesus. And then following Easter, we have a season now which is going to play out some of the implications of Easter. And what's that season looking back? Okay, so we only get to wear red on 1 week for Pentecost. Red's kind of a rare color, except Passion Week, Pentecost. Also, if you ever go to anything like an ordination, people be wearing red. If you go to a special day in which a particular saint or historic Christian is being celebrated, often red will be celebrated, or red will be worn. And then following Pentecost, we go into this long season of green. It's sometimes called ordinary time, also sometimes it's called Pentecost tide. And there's this idea that now post-Easter, and after the Spirit is sent down at Pentecost, we're in this time that's ordinary, okay, which is like probably like the worst misnomer that you could ever give to this part of the church here. Because really, this green time that we live in for half the year is intended to be Pentecost tide, which basically means we're now living out this fruitful life in the Holy Spirit because of what has been purchased for us on the cross, affirmed in Easter, and descended and sent down at Pentecost. And so the ordinary time of the Christian church is a life of fruitfulness and life in the Spirit. Green, a color of growth, a color of life. And during these seasons, we're often reading letters of the New Testament, the letters of Paul, some of these letters that tease out the implications of what it means to have life by the Spirit. So our calendar each year is based around the life of Christ, and it's especially there's two cycles that deal with his birth and his death. And the idea here is that rather than telling Jesus that he needs to get with our American calendar, we're trying to retrain ourselves for us in our culture to get with the cycles of the life of Christ. We're trying to form us and our families, our hearts, into thinking about entering into the life of who Jesus is. So this is the church calendar. It kind of functions as another context for us in our worship. Context here. Now, part of the reason why in the Anglican tradition, the physical context is important is because we don't buy into this idea. If we're worshiping just in the evangelical stream right here, sometimes what can be overemphasized is this dichotomy, this division between physical material stuff and spiritual stuff. And so physical material stuff, like your 9-to-5 job and like your home and your neighborhood, those things are not really important. You know, prayer, evangelism, that stuff's all important. And there can be a real, sometimes a too strong of a division between those things. What comes to us from the Catholic stream is this idea that yes, God is present in the Word of God. Yes, He's present through these spiritual things, but also God is powerfully present with us in things like bread and wine. And He reveals Himself uniquely and powerfully actually through physical matter and material. And the life that we're going to live forever is not just a life of our spirit up in some ether realm of heaven, but actually the end of the book says that Jesus is coming back to earth. He was raised bodily to the physical body, and He's going to come back to this earth with heaven in tow. Heaven and earth are going to become one, and we're going to live this forever beautiful existence, and it's going to be a physical existence, not just a spiritual existence. And so along with that kind of theology, sometimes it's called an incarnation theology. The fact that we believe God's actually interested in physical material stuff and not just spiritual stuff. This incarnational theology means that we love getting to come together to hear God's word preached, but also we actually believe that we want to invest in a way physically that helps us connect with those spiritual things. Sometimes we lost some of this in the Reformation, and so we have some branches of Christianity that said, oh, and sometimes for good reason, you know, physical stuff can be, in the same way that spiritual things can become overemphasized, physical things can be overemphasized. And so in the High Middle Ages, you had so many statues and distractions going around that nobody even knew what the Word of God said. And, you know, the priests were so far off that, you know, they're, people weren't able to connect with God and Spirit in some sense. So I understand, but part of the Reformation went a little too far in some situations in which they said, well, we can't have any beautiful pictures, we can't have any decorations in the church, we just need to have a pulpit with a Bible, and otherwise it just needs to be a plain box that we're in. We don't buy that. We think that's gone too far. And so we believe that there's a physical context that actually helps us enter into the spiritual things that we worship. So, anybody know what this is? Upside down cross, right? Any other guesses?
Church.
This is a church. Okay, I didn't know that.
I see proportions. The
proportions. There you go. The doors gave it away. This is church, and historically, in the high church, the Catholic stream, this is the shape of the church. And obviously, part of the reason why this is the shape of the church is the priest had shot with the shape of a cross, and often this would be like your altar and your sanctuary space here. So this is the sanctuary space here. And so this would be your altar. And often this altar would be facing east. And these are all physical things, by the way, that can help lead our hearts, lead our minds into worship. We're entering into this place that it's in a cruciform, cross-shaped place. We're facing east. Any reasons, any guesses why we might be facing east in our worship? Even better, good guess. Even better than Rome, the Word of God says that when Jesus returns, He's going to come and return from the east. And so it's an orientation towards this conviction that Jesus is actually going to come back. And if He does show up while we're worshiping, well, guess what? We're going to be looking right in the right direction when He shows up and cracks the sky. It's a reminder that Jesus promised. And often you'll have like your musicians off to one side and some of your, over here's a sink in what's called the sacristy. Now with this sink, for instance, in a traditional church, the sink, rather than just going down into the sewage, we would use this sink area here, and our little church here has one. And they would have special plumbing in the sink that would go directly into the earth. And so that way, when we're rinsing off the elements, the wine and the bread that was unused, most of it would be consumed, but there would still be parts of it that would not be used. It will go down the sink, and that will go directly into the earth, just as a sign of respect. Like, think, for instance, if you were dealing with someone's ashes of a loved one. Because those ashes, in some ways, are part of that person and reflect that person, you treat them with the utmost respect and dignity. And in the same way, when we celebrate Eucharist, we call down God's presence on the bread and wine. We believe Jesus is really present with us in those elements, and so we treat them with the respect, even in the way that the church is desiring. So we come in this direction here. This is sometimes called the nave, N-A-V-E. And I mentioned last week, this is a boat term, and this would be where the rowing or the heavy lifting would be. And in our culture today, we emphasize spectator sports. We emphasize performance. We show up and at a concert, and the lights turn low, and the spotlights go on somebody on stage, and they're supposed to entertain us, and we just consume and take it on. With liturgical worship, the word liturgy means the work of the people. And so part of what's being understood as worship is this something that we're all doing together. We're all rowing. We're all contributing. The prayers aren't just for somebody else to pray, but we're also praying some of those prayers. We're participating together. So this would be traditionally where the rowers are, where are those who are contributing to the worship. And then this here is obviously where we would see the sacrament, and there's a lot of similarities here with what we think of as the worship, even in the Old Testament, where when you would come into the tabernacle or you would come into the temple, you would come into this holy place, and then you would back here in the holiest place of all, you would have what in the Old Testament? Ark of the Covenant, right? The golden ark, which is like the throne of God. It's that place where God sits. So similarly, as you come into the sanctuary today, there's an altar here. And we'll have two primary white cloths on the altar. There's one big white cloth and then a smaller white cloth. And these represent the grave clothes of Christ, the cloth that wrapped his body, the cloth that wrapped his head. And when we celebrate Eucharist on that table, similar to the Old Testament with the throne of God, we believe Jesus actually is there with us. That his presence, in a very real and beautiful way, is right there with us. And so similar to the Holy of Holies in the Old Testament, we believe in our worship and in our space that Jesus is powerfully with us there. You'll notice in many chapels in the High Church tradition that there'll be a little light over here, like a little red light. And if you see this little red candle or this little red light lit, that means that not only is this a beautiful sacred place where we worship, but it also means that right back here there's a little space. It's called a tabernacle. And inside the tabernacle will be sacrament. So there'll be wine and there'll be bread that's been blessed that week. So if the pastor or priest needs to go and serve somebody who's shut in or something like that, the sacrament is present. And this little light means that as you come in to this place of worship, there's a part of Holy Communion that's been blessed in this place of worship. And you'll often see a cross here above the tabernacle. And then also you'll often see some kind of central cross, sometimes behind the altar. In this particular church, it's elevated. Have y'all noticed the wooden cross right here? And then often your musicians, your worship leaders, some degree will be off to the side. And the idea is we're not worshiping a personality. We're not worshiping a celebrity. We're not worshiping anybody else who's seated on this altar right here. Our attention is on the person of Jesus. And he's the one really we want exalted and contemplated and enjoyed in the service. And to the degree that Jesus is increased and we are decreased, to that extent, Christ-centered worship. We want our attention to be on him. That's some of the physical context. I know we're about out of time here.
It's 4:50.
Okay, yeah, so I'm going to land the plane, and then next time we can go through the liturgy if we want to. And so, just a couple words about the physical stuff. This is a stole. A stole will go on those who have been hands laid on them and have been set aside to help lead us in worship. When you show up at a mechanic, you know, it's kind of nice to see like the official credential and, you know, they completed their school. Okay, I know this guy's not going to mess up my car. My car's important to me. When we come to the care of our souls and the spiritual well-being of our family, it's nice to know that these folks have been vetted. They've been through years of training, of prayer. And if you see someone wearing a stole, that means they've been through the process. This person is designated as someone that is a leader of a local congregation. It also represents part of the yoke of Christ, that some of that shepherding yoke of Christ has been put on these individuals to help carry some of that load of leadership in Christ's church. Now, since the pastors and the priests have a special consecration being set aside for ministry, does that mean the laity, which means everybody else who's a baptized Christian, does that mean they do not have a ministry? Not at all. In fact, the Word of God says that we are a nation of priests. And it's a unique mystery and grace that God has set aside a portion of the nation of priests to be priests to the nation of priests. But all of us have a calling as well, similar calling in other contexts. Right now, we've been in a kind of an unpacking the box thing and packing the box thing back up, and so we haven't been rolling out the full procession and all the pieces. But I'll introduce those anyways, and you know we might see them in the future. But this big guy, usually the stole will be underneath. This big guy is called a chasuble, and this would be something that is worn at the moment of Eucharist, when the Great Thanksgiving is celebrated. And this is the equivalent of going to the five-star dinner and putting on your tuxedo and your nice dress. It signifies that what we believe we're doing right now is a high point of our week. It's a special moment for us in our worship. And we want it to be celebrated with beauty. So that's a chasuble. Often there'll be a procession and a recession. A precession meaning it's like a little parade, right? Eventually you would have a crucifer, which is the person who carries the cross. You have your clergy and your priests. You would have often musicians or other leaders. And the procession would often come here, and the cross would stop here. And then those who are going to be helping lead the service would process into the sanctuary. And part of this is supposed to be this future moment when we all get to process and come forward into the presence of Christ one day. Often people will be robed in white, cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Another interesting point is as you come into the chapel, there's a little bit of water right here, so a little glass of water right there. And often, if we're just from the evangelical stream, maybe sometimes just from the Pentecostal stream, you got baptized once and maybe you remember kind of when it was, maybe you don't, but you don't often think a lot about your baptism afterwards. One of the things that we get from the Catholic stream is that our baptism is really important. And it's actually by baptism that we're welcomed into God's presence. We're forgiven of our sins. That's the way we entered into our faith in Christ. And so as you come in, often people will dip their fingers in the waters and they'll cross themselves. And that's a way of remembering their baptism, the fact that I was washed in the waters. And
so all the people who have been baptized would do it. So I wouldn't necessarily think Jackson would be left.
So that's a way, if it would be meaningful for you in worship to remember your baptism, the fact that you've been able to cleanse yourself through that, and that's something. Yeah, it's there. It's small. It's there. That could be meaningful as well. So the procession being a great parade, coming into God's presence, and then a service, simply a great going out. And all this is designed to be part of a gospel reenactment. We're reenacting, we're putting on a little skit, a little play every week as part of our feast of worship that says, we've been welcomed into God's presence, now we're going out into the world to be God's presence into the world. So it's a faithful way to be a Christian. I mean, it has breadth to it. It's rich. It gleans from lots of different sources, and also it's not unnecessarily divisive. You know, like drawing lines all over the place and dropping you know, bombs at each other. We want to be united. But at the same time, we recognize that God has been active in all sorts of different traditions and denominations historically. So, as we go into worship today, I'd like to invite us to recognize that worship is a feast.